So welcome to our first class, reading and discussing Richard Rohr's newest book, The Divine Dance, about the Trinity. And I'm not sure how long this will go, as far as how many weeks. We'll just see how we move along with it. So I've often found that people have strong feelings about this idea of Trinity one way or another, or sometimes confused feelings or thoughts about Trinity. And I would invite you, as we begin, to tell me what do you think of when you hear the word Trinity, or what has been your experience of this idea, this concept of God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Anybody have anything to say about that?
I grew up a Congregationalist.
Uh-huh.
And the minister that I grew up with did not believe in the Trinity.
Uh-huh.
He never said Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Wow.
Ever.
Yeah. And there are quite a few denominations that are like that.
For example, what?
For example, the Apostolic Pentecostal denomination. They are oneness people. They'll talk about, you know, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit as being just a way of expressing different aspects of one God. Okay, so that's not that unusual to hear that and to have that kind of view. But we're gonna unpack some of that as well through our study over the next few weeks. So, any other experiences or feelings associated with Trinity or the doctrine of the Trinity?
Well, I grew up Baptist, and it was Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. I never could understand why we had to have those three people, those three entities there to be a Trinity. What was the purpose of it in the first place?
Yeah.
And the example they always used was snow, ice, and water.
So very common.
Yeah, and so that's the only thing I could that I could relate to, but it still didn't make any sense because you pray God.
Mm-hmm. Which also may be kind of modalist in the sense of water, ice, and steam being just different modes of one thing. Did anybody else get sermons about, or children's sermons about, how you explain how three are actually one? Anybody remember that sort of thing? Or a discussion in a class or something?
Eggs.
Huh?
Eggs.
Yeah, eggs. Uh-huh. Tell us the eggs one, Teresa.
Well, you know, it's the yolk, the white, and the shell.
Yeah.
Same thing like the ice and the fire. Ice, water, and steam.
Yeah. Another common one is the shamrock, or the you know, the three parts of the of that. There's a lot of different things that people have used, and that's kind of what he begins with, is the idea that we get caught up on trying to explain. We're talking math when the language of Trinity is really not about math and figuring out how this, you know, this thing works, or how you know, God in physical form, and so he talks about language of movement and relationship and the space in between, rather than three objects. He talks about three verbs, if you will, and starts to break down this kind of concrete idea of Father, Son, and Spirit. Anybody else have any experiences that you'd like to relate? I remember the first year preaching and going through the lectionary and the church year, and you come to a particular day in the church year that is Trinity Sunday, and that was quickly became that first year and thereafter the Sunday that I hated most. Because it felt like I had to preach a doctrine. You know, there's this doctrine about it, and then try to explain all this stuff or try to make sense of this this concept. And I finally just stopped preaching about the Trinity on Trinity Sunday. We were sneaking under the, you know, Trinity Sunday in and not talk about the Trinity. And there's been also for me some animosity of the idea of Trinity, just simply in terms of the history of the church. And because early on, there's 300 years of discussion in the Christian movement about the identity of Jesus Christ and what that's about. to talk about him as being divine, but also to talk about him as being human. And then this discussion about Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, which we certainly get those kind of descriptions of God in parts of the New Testament. Some would even say in kind of allusions to the Old Testament as well. But we certainly don't get the word Trinity, and we don't get this worked out doctrine, this worked out doctrinal kind of statement that we get in the 4th century in the history of the church. So, you know, you've heard me preach before, and I talk about early on, there wasn't that kind of distinction so much, and for Paul especially, the Spirit of God is also the Spirit of Christ and the continued presence of Christ with us, and he mixes those metaphors and those ideas. It's not this distinct Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so the doctrine of the Trinity in one way serves to kind of unite church, unite the thought of the church around this common image of what God is. And some of the philosophical language that they use very early on in that is this kind of metaphysical object, who's the Father, who's the Son, who's the Holy Spirit, and trying to talk about unity in diversity and things like that. But they're almost, they are to a large part literalizing this imagery as you know, kind of like supernatural beings. The Son is this actual human-looking or, you know, actual persona or person, and Father is another person, and Spirit is another person, and they tend to literalize that. And again, some of that's in the politics, engaged in the politics of the early church. However, very early in the tradition and more deeply in the tradition, even those people that did some of that original philosophical work around Trinity always understood this to be more of a mystical or spiritual symbol and expression rather than it being concrete. The Cappadocians were these these great theologians, but they were also great mystics, and there's a group of them, and they themselves state in their writings that Trinity is the best description we have of God, but this is not God itself. Any description of God or naming of God or defining of God is not the thing itself, and is only designed to help us experience and get into this experience of that divine life. So they understood that. And then after that, there are hundreds and hundreds of years of devotional and spiritual literature contemplating the Trinity. That is a deep spiritual symbol and spiritual metaphor for the spiritual quest. And you'll see Richard Rohr doing that as well. In some cases, when he talks, he seems very concrete, as if it are these three persons, you know, and he's very concrete about that. He also refers to the book The Shack. Get the name of the guys that's back here somewhere. Anyway, anybody read The Shack?
No.
Yeah. Okay. What'd you think of The Shack?
Huh? Walter's Young.
Huh?
Young? Isn't his name Young?
Yeah. So The Shack is the story that's told about this person going on this journey, this person that's in deep grief, and he goes on this journey, he goes to the shack, and there's these depictions of the Father, mm-hmm. Son, and Spirit that he is encountering in these personages in his experience over the weekend. And it's a healing, you know, process for him. I thought The Shack got a little bit too literal sometimes for me. It was kind of like, okay, you know, it's a little too literal. But the point is that, the way Richard Rohr says it is all language about God, and really all language about anything, is metaphor. And a metaphor has a connection to the thing that it's describing, but is not the thing itself. And to literalize a metaphor is to lose the whole point of the metaphor. The metaphor is trying to describe something ultimately that can't be described. And so it is pointing toward, it is inviting into an experience of what that metaphor is describing, but the metaphor is not the thing itself. And again, Rohr will kind of go back and forth with this, sometimes sounding very concrete and sounding very literal, but then he'll then bring us right back again to go, but it's a metaphor. It's always metaphor. And in describing the Trinity, he's not only describing or trying to talk about what God looks like, and I say what God looks like, not what God is, because it's metaphor. What does God look like? That's what he's talking about when he's talking about Trinity. But he's also talking about what we look like. And the point is well taken that when we try to describe God, we're also describing something deeply about our own selves, about our own reality, our own existence, even our own psychology. So we're going to hear him talk about what we look like, too, in the book. But he's also making the claim that this Trinitarian kind of metaphor is also descriptive of what the universe looks like, what reality or existence itself looks like. So what I'm going to try to do is track some of these metaphors through his writing and see how many he gives us and see how they relate. And because it's metaphor, you who want a definition, a strict, tight, fully formed definition of Trinity or God or us or universe will probably be disappointed because he's going to give you one metaphor and he's going to give you another metaphor that's completely different from that metaphor or maybe even contradicts in some ways the description of the metaphor he's just given you. Because as he understands that he is not writing this book to explain the Trinity to you, he is writing this book to invite you to the dance. And that's his first metaphor. Is a metaphor of dance. And he has on his front of his book this wonderful icon by Rubliff of the Trinity. And icons in the Eastern tradition are interesting expressions. They're visual metaphors, if you will, because they are not trying to draw what people and things actually look like. One of the other famous icons of Rubliff is an icon of Christ. Christ the Peacemaker, I think, is what it's often called. It was lost during, I think it was World War I, with the armies coming through Russia and all that kind of stuff. And it was actually rediscovered years later under a step of a church or a house or something that was like half buried, and they recovered this icon of Christ. And the icon itself looks like no one you've ever seen really in real life. The earlobes are very long. The way the eyes and the face is structured, the nose and everything, it's not what people really look like. It's a spiritualization of a human image. And you see this in a lot of other cultures, too. And the Christ icon is one that is a lot of people have written about, and it is striking. And in the Eastern tradition, these icons are meant to be contemplated, to be meditated on. You're supposed to spend time with that image. And so the image, some people in the West say, well, that's idolatry, all this imagery, you know, these images of God and all this kind of stuff, you know. Well, that's not what it is, because that's not what it's intended to be. It's intended to put you actually in touch with or have an experience of what is being portrayed in the picture itself. And again, in that sense, it's a metaphor. It's meant to bring something into the experience. It's not intended to be a snapshot. And it's certainly not intended to explain what the Trinity this is what the Trinity really looks like. And if you spend a little bit of time with this image, I would tell you that that would also be a great use of your time in our study of this particular book. And you notice that they all look kind of the same, right? Very similar, but little slight differences. And they are sitting in this circle, okay? And that is another metaphor, the idea of the circle. contrast the circle image with the image that we, that many people have for the idea of God, which is a pyramid, with God on top, in control, in dominion over all the rest. Everything else is down from God. And that's also an image that really supports the idea of the separation of God from us. The separation of the Creator from the creation. And in some circles of theology, that's almost the founding idea, is that God is God, and we are we, and we can have communion with God, but God is always separate. God is always projected into the heavens, or projected into the separate being, because everything down here is kind of messy and dirty and, you know, profane, and God is holy, and God is lifted above, and so these two are completely separated from one another, you know, and so the big man upstairs is one kind of expression of that, and the idea that that God only sits in judgment and rewards them, those who are good down here and reflect the divine image, but it's based on this basic metaphysical separation between the divine and the material. This model of Trinity, as Rohr explores it, blows that concept completely away and tells us that that was never the intention of our tradition and the scriptures to have this great divide. But in fact, the Trinity model itself is one of intimate interaction. And so the dance metaphor is the dance of Father, Son, and Spirit. Again, it's a metaphor. But the beautiful part of that metaphor is that there's a fourth partner in the dance. And the fourth partner in the dance is, in fact, us. And, in fact, all of creation is part of the dance. And, again, you can literalize this to four people, human beings, dancing, or you can begin to let it speak more deeply about what this divine thing is that we talk about that really isn't a thing at all. And again, who we are and who we are in relationship to that that reality. And Rohr, as you go through the book, will take you on a wonderful journey into those ideas. So you're going to have to hold this loosely as you read it. And there'll be parts of it that will completely confuse you, because sometimes the way he uses the metaphors, again, he's not trying to explain even the metaphor. He's given us the metaphor as an invitation in. So there's another one that he uses that's important then that he introduces in this first introductory part. That is flow. And we'll see him develop that metaphor in some very nice and beautiful ways. But again, he begins at the very beginning to talk about Trinity in terms of relationship, relationality, and in terms of movement, a dance, a flow, rather than static objects. that the whole thing itself is a movement and a flow. And connecting then relationality with that flow is the flow of love in and out of the world. Okay? Any questions or anything so far? I'm kind of going through kind of quickly. I wanted to catch a couple more of his metaphors here. Okay. All right.
Why are we doing this?
Because we enjoy concentrating on minutia, and that's a great question. And there's been points in my own spiritual life where I would have asked the same question: why, you know, these doctrinal things? And again, tied to this is a idea of the nature of Jesus Christ. What is that? How do you mean that? And when you try to look at that in terms of just explanation or scientific worldview, it makes absolutely no sense. At least to me, it never did. But if you see that, and this will also help us explore that. When you see this as a metaphor for What in our experience is both eminently human and transcendently divine in our own experience of our reality, then the Trinity has always been an image in the Christian tradition that helps us get at that. And that's what we're going to be trying to get at. Again, not trying to explain, but trying to hear the invitation that this great description gives to us. Okay, is that satisfied, at least for now? We're going to have to keep going, but keep raising that. Okay, all right. So, let's see. Let's load the last. Let me. There's one here that I was going to. So, an infinite current of love streams without ceasing, to and fro, to and fro, to and fro, gliding from the Father to the Son and back to the Father in one timeless happening. The metaphor of the dance. And again, the hospitality and the invitation for us to participate, which he would say we're participating already, whether we know it or not, or care or not. And so for Rohr, this idea that we participate in the life of God from the very beginning is for him and for the Franciscan order the basis of what we call salvation. This, in fact, is God's plan A, as he describes it, that God has set up our very existence to be in this relationship or to be in this existence as part of the divine life. And again, whether we know it or accept it or not, that's the reality that God has created from. And the Trinity idea can also help us with that, the idea of creation. And we'll talk about that later on. So for the Franciscans and for Rohr certainly, but for a whole order that's part of the Catholic Church, salvation is not about a sacrifice of atonement. It's not about something God did, or his plan B, as Rohr calls it, in order to rescue us after we were created and screwed it all up. A plan B, a rescue mission, as Bishop Spong describes, that God had to do something to make the parts fit again and to make it all right, and to some degree, the way it's presented, to make God love what God has created, to make God forgive and accept what God has created. And Rohr would say God has always loved what God has created, and there's nothing that we could do that could ever change that. And so from the very beginning, but our salvation in a personal sense is when we come to that awareness of that, of what underlies our reality and our existence is in fact a boundless mercy, a radical grace, and an unconditional love. That's what it already is. And the problem is on our side, we do all kinds of things to twist ourselves in rebellion or resistance to that kind of radical love and that kind of experience. And so we do all kinds of things to protect ourselves from it. And again, what Paul talks about in unfortunate language as flesh and spirit, contrasting flesh and spirit, is really a contrast of a self that is separated from this deeper aspect of who we are, what Thomas Merton called the false self, and this real self that in fact is always in communion, even union with that divine life. And so salvation is coming to realize that, and then more and more through the course of our lives learning to live into that. Because radical love radical love is dangerous stuff, because it challenges all of our sense of that false self and who we think we are and who we've made ourselves to be and all the masks that we wear, and invites us to abandon that to a deeper reality of who we are that will in fact transform us and will also transform our relationship with the rest of the world. that's pretty, now that's salvation I can hope for.
Pretty powerful.
It is pretty powerful. And he's going to take us in and out of that idea again and again, again using some beautiful metaphors to do that. So if you feel challenged by this book, not only on an intellectual level, but if you feel challenged by this book on a heart level and a soul level, then check yourself if you're starting to back away and resist maybe that a little bit. And I would invite you to remain open to that reality, because that's what he's talking about. And then finally, in the introductory part, he makes this amazing claim. Our final goal of union with God is grounded in the creation itself, and also in our own unique creation. And so he is saying that our existence itself, the universe itself, reality itself, is based on love and original blessing. And he uses that term purposefully, original blessing, because we're all familiar with the term original sin, which for some people is the starting place for how we think of ourselves as human beings. What Richard Rohr is saying is, and again the Franciscan order is saying, and St. Francis is saying, we begin with this original blessing, this original relatedness that we already have because it's the foundation of our existence in God. We are already related. And I see this theme again and again in both Christian spiritual traditions and others as well, that it's not so much that our situation of feeling disconnected from this greater reality that we somehow sense and intuit, but somehow feel like our fellowship has been broken from, that our restoration is not about just forgiveness or, you know, becoming religious or finding God. It's really about remembering. There's a sense of remembering what we already are. You know, on the table upstairs it says, in remembrance of me, and that's a deep word in the Greek theological tradition. And it's not just about a memorial of somebody who died. It's about remembering who we are. And that's partly one way of thinking about what our faith or what the spiritual tradition calls us to, is a remembrance of what in fact is already true and has always been true and will always be true. And that's the approach then of how Richard Rohr and folks like him understand salvation and the life of faith and sanctification, the ongoing. And he uses a phrase that's part of a lot of our liturgies, Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. Well, we can literalize that, but it's really talking about our own experience of Christ and what that means. That we have died in Christ, we are risen in Christ, but Christ is always coming again through us and through our lives and as our lives in the world. So he'll go through that again and again. So I put a lot of stuff out there. Anything you want to talk about? Yeah.
I just would like to comment. The Trinity, as I understood it growing up, was, you know, this idea. And I know we don't talk about like Satan or anything like that, but and that could be a metaphor too. I mean, as we discuss in here a lot too. So I understand that.
Yeah.
Learning a lot of that in here. But how that God, you know, the Son, the Holy Spirit, I leave you with the Comforter, you know, He is in me, is greater than was in this world. This whole idea that Satan is running all this down here that you were just kind of touching on earlier.
Yeah.
That this God needs to be up here, like, correcting all this stuff and, you know, judging and all that. So, I mean, that's a lot of, I think, I can go on and on, but we only have a little bit of time here. But just in that snippet that, you know, a lot of this world is sinful, and we need these things in order to escape that, you know. So, I mean, you've touched on that in other sessions, too.
Yeah.
But is that kind of what the setup is for the story of this, that we need this Trinity for that? Or is it, and you can go on and say it's totally something separate, too, you know.
Yeah.
It's ego, it's pride, you know, I need to separate from those things.
So. Yeah. Well, he will say, again, he sounds very solid at one point, and then he'll fade, but at one point he says, really, it doesn't matter what we call the three persons of the Trinity. That's not the point, you know? It really doesn't matter. And he acknowledges that the imagery we use of, like, Christ and Holy Spirit merge and confuse at certain points, and what we think of as the Father merges with the Son. It's not... They're almost, and I think he says it like this, they're interchangeable in a lot of ways. Because what these ideas of Father, Son, and Spirit are meant to do are to invite us into this mystery, which ultimately is a mystery and remains a mystery. But to invite us into that and to play this game, to dance this dance, to be willing to let go of the need for this is exactly what it is and how we define it. Okay, but that very approach itself is contrary to what we see so much in religion as this kind of, we will define what God is. And our definition is the only right definition. And he talks about our relationship with other religions in here too. Is this not being this, we're saying this is what God is and they're wrong. That's not the point at all of this. And I'm going to say a little bit about that upstairs today. In a lot of ways, we would prefer a judging God. We'd prefer a God who put out the rules and said, these are the rules.
We don't have to.
And you don't. And if the people who obey these rules or accept this particular vision of faith or vision of God and agree with and attach themselves to the institution, those are the ones that God will favor. Those are the ones that God will reward. And the people who don't follow those rules and don't accept our explanation of what God is or our institution and what it offers and all that kind of stuff, those are the people that God will punish. And we can certainly find any proof, a billion proof texts in Scripture to support that kind of idea. And part of that for me is that Scripture itself, especially in the Old Testament and then moving into the New, is an evolution of people's experience of and language about God. It's a evolution of metaphors, if you will. And what starts out in the Hebrew, among the Hebrew people, as a warrior God in the sky who has chosen them, a tribal God, if you will, who blesses them and smites their enemies, begins to unravel as the story of Israel begins to develop and continues to unravel, and a deeper message continues to get included both in the Jewish tradition and in the Christian tradition too. So we can find a lot of language about wrath, even in Paul talking about wrath, but he's mostly talking about God's wrath against the systems of oppression that are current in his day, that God will bring an end to that. That's kind of the main idea. And of course, we've all heard about the great white throne judgment and judgment at the end of the day and all this kind of stuff. That language needs to be unpacked very carefully in the context of what each person was talking about in that kind of language. But the point is that a lot of people really like that kind of language. They like this idea of God, we're on God's side and everybody else is not. Or this is what, and to some degree it can produce a bit of order in our lives, you know, that if we'll just get on board with God's program, we'll be okay and God will bless us and, you know, God will reward us. And it's this whole idea of approach to God as reward and punishment, and therefore sets up an idea that the way we must, the only way we can really have a relationship with God or avert God's wrath is to appease God's wrath with some kind of sacrifice. And sacrifice is an interesting, the volcano God, for crying out loud, throw the virgin in the volcano your crops are going to be okay. It's an old idea when we start trying to think about a bigger reality than just ourselves. How do we relate to that reality? And is that reality benign or loving or angry? Which one is it? You know? So that's a common approach. And people would, you know, I mean, law and order is kind of based on that whole idea, reward and punishment, right? It's kind of And what a wonderful line. We were talking about the turn of phrases that Richard Rohr has that are just gorgeous. One of them is that God's justice is never retribution, it's always restorative. It's always intended to bring a person back to their right mind, bring a person back into community, bring a person back into their better selves. So it's never retribution, it's always restoration. And bear in mind that Richard Rohr, who he calls his father in many cases, St. Francis, Francis of Assisi. And St. Francis is a remarkable figure in the Christian tradition who infuriated the church and clerics and religious of his day. Because he said, it's not about authority, it's not about the institution, it's not about power, it's not about judgment, it's not about an angry God. It's about a God that we participate in. It's about a God whose beauty and goodness is everywhere to be seen and everywhere to behold. But there's a lot of St. Francis's in our tradition, actually. And the Franciscan order itself, you know, we tend toward, we want this controlling, dominating, imperial, king God kind of image. We still are very drawn to that, you know. And even the Franciscans fell prey, you know, when they came to the New World. They were responsible for many of the monasteries and all along the California coast. But they also had become there was a certain kind of end of the world kind of theology that had entered into the Franciscan order, and they saw this as evangelizing by force and in many cases in slavery the native people, when we win the people of the new world, then the kingdom will come in and Christ will return. And they started to literalize that stuff themselves, and the soldiers that were with them wore belt buckles. They have, you know, ones they've dug up in California and some of the museums and monasteries. It says it was the old Constantinian vision, the cross in the sky, by this conquer, by this symbol conquer. And so we tend to go back to that kind of idea of God. And we tend to, when we do have that idea of God, we tend to assume that that's the only right vision of God and the only one that Christianity has ever preached or ever talked about. And really we have this deeper tradition.
But I think for me this makes it really easy, you know. Yeah. If you say, well, that you use the term pyramid.
Yeah.
It makes it very easy if you accept the pyramid, because then, well, there is something out there somewhere, you know, which is out of reach, but decides what is right and what is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And therefore, in a way, you don't have responsibility.
Yeah.
You don't have the responsibility to define what's right and what's wrong.
Right.
And I think what this is inviting, not this book only, but what Rohr is inviting me, mm-hmm. is, well, no, I see in the Trinity the Son as a metaphor. A metaphor.
Yeah, metaphor.
of us.
Yeah.
And so what you said, there are actually four on the table in the whatever four is in Trinity. Well, that lifts us to a different level.
Mm-hmm.
Or lowers God to a different level.
Mm-hmm.
And the Trinity. So now we are suddenly part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you're suddenly part of it, there is nobody who tells you that's right and that's wrong.
Yeah.
Now it's up to you, because now you're part of it. Now you need to define. Now, yeah. I think it brings, you know, in one way, it lifts the responsibility tremendously up.
It lifts
our responsibility tremendously up, and there is no excuse anymore. And I think that's, for me, is the difficult part.
Mm-hmm.
Because then you sit there and you go, like, you know, you look at what happens in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Of all the good stuff, that's easy.
Mm-hmm.
All the bad stuff, that's rough.
Mm-hmm.
And you're responsible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it's It's I think it's tough.
Yeah.
I think it's a tough
very
message.
Hard. Very hard to be Christian. And look at the life cycles we have. We have, look at you have a new baby, and you have your mother has passed.
Right.
Look at what God's given us. We have kids, and they challenge all the time. I don't know if you've been around kids much, but they're constantly challenging, constantly.
Mm-hmm.
And we work with them. Mm-hmm. And then they are hopefully mature. They get more mature and assume responsibility. And then they get old and think, I think I'm beginning to get it now, and they pass. And so, it's constant. And look, God has given us that. I mean, our universe has given us that.
Yeah.
And so talk about flow
in
the human existence.
Yeah.
And how kids challenge us all the time as they are learning their own responsibility. So we have to challenge ourselves to that degree too.
Yeah, yeah. And another way of describing that process through life is death and resurrection, which is what our tradition gives us.
Right.
Because we're constantly dying to something. We're constantly experiencing the sorrows and the realities of our existence, but out of that also comes a greater depth. And out of that comes new possibilities for growth. People who are always trying to avoid any kind of death, for all that death represents, trying to cling to life and trying to cling to, deny their own mortality and deny anything that might threaten or hurt, become very, very shallow people. Because you've got to go through experiences of loss and death and failure and all those kind of things in order to grow into a bigger person. These images that our faith gives to us, and the idea too of I'm reading another one of his books. It's called The Immortal Diamond, so I'm blending, mixing some of the stuff up, where he really talks more about our makeup and the false self and true self and Christ being, in fact, what we all are. And the suffering of God just through the very incarnation in a suffering reality, and therefore sharing our suffering. So some great things there. But the kind of external focused church, whether it's Catholic or Protestant or whatever it is, that invites you through in mostly external forms into some kind of relationship with God or some kind of situation with God. That then gives us some kind of sense of assurance, usually an assurance, and gives us a certainly things to learn and do and grow and tells us what we should do and shouldn't do, but then gives us some kind of assurance, usually about life after death, that we're going to be able to be in heaven forever and all that kind of stuff. You can live through that process of religion your whole life and never be called to any kind of transforming experience of our deeper self, in our minds and our hearts and in our spirits. Nothing that tells us we have to, continue the journey, that we're on a journey, and that this journey is for us, in fact, to realize this greater experience of this incarnation of God in our lives. I have a friend, he's a pastor in Montrose, and he says that, he's doing a lot of Rohr stuff with his folks, but it's a very conservative congregation, or has been historically. And some of his people tell him it's not about, he said, we don't have to, he's talking about a spiritual journey and spiritual life and deepening, spiritual practice and all those kinds of things. They're going, we don't have to do any of that stuff because Christ did it for us. He died, he shed his blood, he died for us, and we don't have to do anything. We don't have to do any of that stuff. We just have to accept what he did for us. And so no sense that there's this greater possibility that our faith is offering us rather than just some assurance. And I've seen so many of those folks, and this maybe sounds mean, but greatly terrified at time of death.
Pat, on the other side of that, I was telling Pat as I came in, I was talking to my former wife right before I came in, and she said, where are you going? I said, well, we're going to be studying Richard Rohr. She's Catholic, big time Catholic. And there was a pause. And she said, oh, well, no, we don't, no, not him. He's the worst. Here's a woman who's dying. I've known her 30-some years. Wow. She's dying. She believes in that pyramid. Yeah. And she has worked all the years that I've known her obeying the rules of the church.
Yeah.
Now, she's dying. And when Judy met her last year, she said, you know, I don't know that I've ever met anybody with so much faith of what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. She is ready for death. Mm-hmm. She's obeyed the rules. All things, she doesn't want to be bothered with all this.
Yeah.
Because she believes in what those rules are and that she's adhered to them.
Yeah.
So when she crosses that threshold, she's ready.
And I hope she is.
Yeah, no, but I'm just saying, that is the epitome of the other side.
But here's what I see.
I don't believe it, by the way.
And Rohr talks about this in that other book. This is what I see. The process of death, I'm talking about right on the cusp of death, is a process that puts us deeply in touch with this deeper aspect of who we are. There's just something about the way that that goes for most people. If it's a death that's anticipated and there's time, you know, not when you're hit by a bus, that's pretty well, doesn't leave you much time for a reflection, but when you're in that process, and he talks about this being kind of a compacted experience that all spiritual practice puts us in touch with, this deeper question, this deeper place. And for a lot of people, when that happens, when they suddenly start to experience something of that, all these assurances that they got from their religion just don't make any sense anymore. Now they're encountering something. They are already starting to encounter something that is beyond all that stuff, you know? So they either are able to give themselves to that, or if they're still holding on, though, to this external stuff, then that stuff no longer speaks with the same kind of validity that it did before. And they start to wonder, really wonder, is that enough? Is that going to take me there? You know, and they'll, if they're clinging on to that stuff, then that can become a very terrifying experience. Because there's clinging on to stuff that intuitively in this moment of death they know is not what it's about. And that happens again and again, I think, for people. I've seen folks like you're describing, and I hope this doesn't happen for her, but, well, maybe I hope it does. But, I mean, it may be a better experience of people who have been the most solid, you know, they were the Christian's Christian. And when the end comes, man, that puts them in confrontation with something that they had been pushing away by their Christianity most of their life. You know, because that's what Christianity a lot of times does, is insulates us, our religious forms insulate us from this deeper experience of God.
Teresa? Yeah, I've been, I'm glad you picked this book, because I've thought about this for a long time. Like I said, when I was a kid, you know, they had the thing of the egg to understand the Trinity, okay?
Yeah.
Well, an egg is an entity, and like Sharon brought up, there's water and ice and steam. Those are entities, those are physical things. I think we also talked about apples, right? So the skin and the flesh and the seeds, right? These entities. But if you're trying to understand God as an entity, I think maybe the way I'm looking at this is that's going down the wrong path. It's more like understanding God as an activity, dance, you know, the flow in a circle or whatever, and this activity between what's transcendent, what's an external authority, what does our tradition tell us about what's right and wrong, and how do we receive some of this perennial wisdom, and then what do we have internally, you know, like our, if you will, the Holy Spirit guiding each of us internally, our internal idea. And how does that mix up? You know, like Jesus is fully divine, fully human. How do you mix the two? What's external reality and transcendent, and what's internal reality and what's fully immanent? And it's just that activity, that back and forth,
yeah.
More than an entity, more than an egg.
Right,
you know?
And to some degree, all religion and religious expression begins in human experience, in our actual experience of something transcendent. And the way Rohr sometimes talks about that is like knows like. That God is not unlike us, something completely different up in the sky, or we would never be able to even know that. But we touch something in ourselves that is part of ourselves. Like recognizes like. Like knows like. When we have an experience, a genuine experience of God, we intuit it. We know it because we are it. We are it in a certain way. And again, that's a metaphor too. And that doesn't imply that, you know, I'm a supernatural being in some... That has always been the spiritual expression through in so many traditions, and people have been executed for saying, I am God. And they don't mean my ego self is a divine being. They are beginning to understand that at the very core of our being is also the being of God. How do we talk about that? How do we make sense of that? In a sense, that's also the expression of Jesus Christ. The Father and I are one. What do you mean, show you the Father? How long have I been with you? And we turn that into a literalized divine divinity kind of thing, rather than understanding that as in fact the basis of what we all are and what all creation is. So we're going to have a chance to explore these deep thoughts. Remember that Saturday Night Live, deep thoughts. We're going to explore those deep thoughts in our divine dance, in our class together. So bring your questions, bring your ideas. If there's parts that, you know, disturb you deeply, bring your deep disturbances, and we'll try to bring them into conversations. Okay, any last questions or closing words? All right, blessings to you.
Thanks, Dad.